So welcome everybody to this first ever virtual edition of the CASA Distinguished Lectures. So CASA is, as hopefully everybody knows, is our cluster of excellence in Bochum. And we are doing this distinguished lecture for researchers which are distinguished colleagues. And I'm super happy that Johan agreed to do this this time. Johan is best known for many, many things, best known for the inventing AES and SHA-3, Ketchak, and is going to talk us on, is going to talk about his new ideas on how to continue with symmetric crypto, how to get rid of all block ciphers, maybe. And all these things I do, but so yeah, I'm super happy that I'm super happy that Johan is here, and I'm looking forward to his presentation. So we are, you are all to all the people who participate and are not able to speak. Please feel free to ask questions in the question and answer part of the of Zoom, and then we can also easily give you speaking rights, and you can ask your question, and so. Let's try to make this a lively discussion. That's what Johan also said he would like to have. So raise your hand, and then we'll start the discussion. Okay, thank you very much. And then I give the floor to Johan. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Gregor, for this nice introduction. And also thanks for inviting me. So it's an opportunity to do some evangelization of not my ideas, but I would say our ideas, because it's all this stuff is based on joint work with a lot of other people. So I listed there, well, the members of the Ketchak team, so Guido, Mikael, and Jill, but also Bart Menink is more and more involved in this kind of stuff. And then Ronnie van Keer is one of our ST, ex-ST colleagues, because I no longer work for ST. His work has done a lot of work on implementation of all this stuff. And then Seth Hofford is, some guy from America, let's say, that sent us some mails, and he was so he had such good ideas that we decided to make him part of the team. And since a few years, he's closely collaborating with us on all this work. And then, of course, I have now here in Nijmegen, I have a research group, and we're also working on these things. So I try to steer them into the way of trying to investigate these things. And the whole idea underlying this presentation, also the work I do, is that there is a better way to do symmetric crypto than block cipher based. And it's not something that you have to take as a fact, but just try to challenge people a bit and do some provocation. And therefore, I think it would be nice to have some discussion. And the first part of this presentation is it's getting, let's say, from conceptual to more technical. To in the beginning, I'm trying to explain what it is we want to do. And at the end, I give some examples how it can be done. But there are many other ways to do it, I guess. But OK, I hope it will become more clear during the talk. OK. So let me first define a bit authenticated encryption, because that's the thing in symmetric crypto that's currently considered to be the thing to implement. Huh? And authenticated encryption is basically a way to protect messages with symmetric crypto, where you want to protect the confidentiality of a part of the message that we call the plain text. And we want to authenticate the plain text together with possibly some header information that we call associated data. So authenticated encryption, the encryption operation consists of converting this associated data and the plain text to a ciphertext and a tag. And sometimes there is no explicit tag, but the tag is part of the ciphertext. That's for later. There is a secret key that governs this computation. And typically, we also have a diversifier. And this diversifier, if you make sure it's unique, if every encryption you make sure the diversifier is unique, you will get here a unique mapping. So even if you take twice the same message consisting of associated data and plain text, if you have a different diversifier, this will be different. So you cannot even see as an attacker. So the attacker model is that the attacker can see this and should not learn about. So this is typically what you send over the line, the ciphertext, the tag, and the associated data. So the associated data, either it can be implicitly known by both sides, but is not considered secret. And that we call the cryptogram. So the cryptogram consists of associated data, the ciphertext, and the tag. And at receiving end, these three things are, this cryptogram is again converted to a message where you recover the plain text. Of course, this associated data is received as such. And for doing that, you also need the diversifier and you need the key. Yeah? So you share a key, it's a symmetric key, crypto, and you have this diversifier. Yeah. And when is this secure? Well, this is actually secure if for an adversary who has seen a lot of, for a given secret key, an adversary who has seen a lot of inputs and outputs, yeah, that for a fresh input that the adversary can learn nothing from looking at this. Yeah, so that basically this, whatever pairs, how many, whatever the amount of pairs of inputs and outputs you got for a particular key, the adversary cannot learn anything about this from this. So this should look basically completely random. And at receiving end, any message, any cryptogram that doesn't come from a valid encryption should give an error. That's basically it. That's kind of the intuition. Okay, so this is authenticated encryption. But we can generalize this to session authenticated encryption, where we keep state in between messages. So what we have is we have a kind of a machine that has state. This is symbolizing the state. And you initialize it with a key and a diversifier. So this diversifier should be unique per startup. And you have it at both sides. So this is the same operation. And then you have a sequence of messages where each message consists of associated data and plain text. And you do an encryption to the ciphertext and the tag. And the cryptogram consists of the associated data, ciphertext, and the tag that is sent. And at receiving end, you get again the plain text, or you get an error. So you get an error if this was an invalid message. So if someone messed with the message. So basically, you only want to get a plain text if this was actually generated by a valid encryptor. So the difference between these two, so between simple authenticated encryption, session authenticated encryption, is what this tag covers. So this tag is supposed to cover all past messages. So that means that if a tag, if here at receiving end your tag is valid, so if your decryptor says your tag is valid, it means that all the messages up to now are valid, and that no messages have been omitted or that no messages have been replayed. That's the idea. Okay. So this is actually not what the talk is about, but I need to first give this background. So how do you, now what in symmetric crypto is a challenge is try to build a system like this, or build a system like this. So to specify these functions. And how this is typically done in, let's say, a standard way, not, this is not exclusive, there are also alternatives, but this is really like the mainstream way of doing it, is you do it in two layers. First, you build a kind of mini encryption scheme, a block cipher. A block cipher that basically encrypts an n-bit string, n-bit plain text to an n-bit ciphertext. And the security goal of this block cipher is that when you key it with a fixed key, it should behave like a random n-bit permutation. So that means if you have a distinguishing experiment where an adversary is faced with a system, and the system is either the block cipher or it's a randomly chosen permutation, so randomly chosen from all possible permutations, the adversary will have a hard time distinguishing it. And we can actually define this PRP distinguishing advantage that's related to the success probability of guessing correctly whether he was talking to a block cipher, key block cipher, or a random permutation. We can actually express this PRP distinguishing advantage as a function of M and M. And M is the data complexity. That's the number of queries you can do to the key block cipher or the random permutation. And N is the computational complexity. That's the amount of computation you can do, for instance, an exhaustive key search. And what we want is we want this distinguishing advantage to be small. We cannot prove that. I don't think that's possible, but at least it has not been done yet for a practical block cipher. But what we can do is we can claim it. So we can say, okay, yes, we claim that for this particular block cipher, we have a bound here that suggests that exhaustive key search is the best possible. Yeah. And then we can just publish the block cipher with that claim. And this is a challenge for cryptanalysts to try to refute that claim. So to show that there is an attack that allows you to distinguish the block cipher with a higher probability than and this advantage suggests. So a block cipher, the assurance about the security is based on public scrutiny. So like DES at the time, so DES was considered secure because many people tried to break it, but nobody succeeded. Until, of course, it was broken. And then we had AES, and AES, even up to date, this day, is not practically broken yet. There were these, of course, these attacks, what are they called again? Big leak attacks that theoretically broke AES, but it's really like, yeah, on the edge. So I think now you can actually, it is not so ridiculous to assume that the best possible attack against AES would be full round AES would be exhaustive key search. That gives us a clear idea of what security is. So, but then this block cipher, that's not enough to do authenticated encryption where your messages, your plain text can have arbitrary length and you can have arbitrary length associated data. Oh yes, I should say, so, and typically when we have a block cipher, we can speak about a safety margin where this relates to the total number of rounds of the block cipher in case of AES 10 and the number of rounds that are broken. So we could say AES, I think 7 rounds are reasonably broken, so you get still got some margin. So that's how we reason about these things. But to do really authenticated encryption, we have to build a mode. And we actually can build a mode calling a random permutation. So that will later, we'll replace that by a block cipher, but we can build a mode of a random permutation. And once we do that, it turns out to be possible to prove an upper bound, also again, as a function of computational and data and computational complexity, prove an upper bound for the probability of breaking. And this probability is then taken over all possible permutations. So you have a random permutation. If you compute the probability of breaking it over all possible permutations, where of course you need to define what breaking is. And this is something you can really combinatorially or using probability theory prove. But of course you need to assume a random permutation. And then by the triangle inequality, you can actually prove that the breaking probability, the probability of breaking this authenticated encryption scheme when you plug in a concrete block cipher is the sum of these two terms. So one term that you can prove and one term that is based on public scrutiny. Yeah? But when you have a block cipher that has been scrutinized a lot, you can actually here get a pretty good idea of the security. So when to give a concrete example, this would be AES. You get some bound that you can assume to be reliable. And this could be, for instance, OCB. And you got here a proof of OCB where this is proven if you indicate you got a random permutation. And the sum will be the breaking probability. So this gives you quite some assurance about security of a block cipher based authentication scheme, authenticated encryption scheme. Okay. Now, there are a number of things with this block cipher based crypto that are not so easy. The first thing is that often these modes can become, well, even if they don't look very complex, their proofs become complex. So, for instance, there was recently the case of OCB where the proof, the conditions that were required for the proof to hold were not satisfied by an instantiation. And this instantiation was already, I think, more than 10 years out there, so before being found. So while you have a proof of security, it turns out that the proof is not valid in this case. Another case was this GCM SIV proof, where there was some problems in the proof. And so the authors, I think the paper already got accepted. Then other people found errors in the proof and they were dismissed as typos by the authors. But the point is that often these proofs are very complex and hard to verify. And a proof that is not verified, yeah, it's not much of a proof. The second thing is the birthday bound. So in most of these security proofs, you get always in these bounds, these epsilon bounds for the mode, you get a term that is quadratic in the data complexity with 2 to the power n in the denominator. And that's the birthday bound. And security basically collapses as soon as the data complexity approaches 2 to the power n divided by 2 blocks, where n is the block length of block size. So if you took a look at this, that's n equals 64, so that's 2 to the power 32 blocks. That's only 32 gigabytes. And Gaëtan Laurent and Kartik, they did some nice attacks on that. So I suggest you follow this this link. So have a look. You can say, okay, but if you make the block cipher wide enough, like AES with its 128 bits, it's not really a problem because 2 to the power 64 is huge. But still, people like to claim some kind of security strength of 128 bits, and 2 to the power 64, yeah, it doesn't give you 128 bits of security anymore. So, okay. And then the third thing is that it looks like, if you look at modern modes, is that block ciphers not really address the right design goals anymore. So what do I mean by that? So one of the design criteria for a block cipher is that its inverse mapping should be efficient. So typically rounds are made so that the inverse of the step functions are efficient, or even that you have a self-involutive structure like this. But most modern modes don't use the inverse block cipher. So if you look at modes, more and more modes don't use the inverse block cipher. And block ciphers are actually designed to be PRP secure. So PRP secure means hard to distinguish from a random permutation. And SPRP means hard to distinguish from a random permutation by an adversary that can also make inverse queries. While most modern modes, they really need PRF, pseudo-random function security. So basically, this difficulty to distinguish the block cipher from a random function. And because of the fixed block length of a block cipher, inherently fixed block length, that aspect makes modes often rather complex because there's always some padding to be done. And then authors of modes, they don't like this length extension due to padding, and then they try to do tricks to keep the cryptogram length the same as the data length, or the ciphertext length the same as the plain text length, and that's where things go wrong. Okay, so these are a number of challenges. Now, can we address those challenges? Yeah, maybe check if people are still following, or I don't know.
I think they are still following. So far, no questions.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, up to now, it's also all quite well-known stuff, I think. So, but what does a block cipher look like? Because this is a thing that we actually have to build. These modes, well, as soon as we got a block cipher, we can construct these modes. And that's quite, I wouldn't say easy, but that's something where we can actually do it in a scientific way, fully. We can prove things, and if we do the right thing, we can build the right stuff. But the block cipher, that's really a bit how should I say, where you have to make use of actual operations to build something that should satisfy some goal. And how is that done? Well, a block cipher is actually a permutation, an n-bit permutation, parameterized by a side input key. So the encryption data path, that's the thing, the part of the algorithm that takes the n-bit plain text and converts it to the n-bit ciphertext or vice versa. It's basically the iteration of a round function. And this round function, then we have design strategies for that. So you got ARX, you got Whitetail strategy. I think it's quite well understood. And in between the rounds or in the rounds, we inject every round typically a round key. And these round keys are coming from a key schedule. The key schedule is maybe a little less understood how to design. But still. So I depict the block cipher with this traffic sign. So it's basically the data path, which goes here from bottom to top, where normally it goes top to bottom. And this is the key input. That's how you can see it. So how can we now maybe do something about this structure to improve the situation? And the first approach is actually to extend the block cipher. So we add a side input as next to the key. And this new side input, it doesn't have to be secret. And it's called a tweak. Yeah, it's not. It's like the key, but it's like non-secret. So now we got where a block cipher is a permutation parameterized by a key value. This is a permutation parameterized by a couple, the key and the tweak. And for each key and a tweak, you got a different permutation. So this presence of the tweak actually allows simplifying modes. And if you look at, for instance, OCB, the specification of OCB, if you plug in a tweakable block cipher, I think it's called TetaCB, is much simpler than OCB with the block cipher. And you can avoid the birthday bound if you make calls to W unique. Because birthday bound is when you achieve, when you start noticing that a permutation is actually a permutation. And that's after 2 to the power n divided by 2 queries. But here, if you make the tweak unique per call, then it's actually where every time you call a different tweak, you have a different permutation. And so by diversifying this as much as possible, you will not reach the birthday bound. So that kind of works. But of course, you introduce also this tweak schedule. So you got the key schedule, you got the data path, and now you also have additionally the tweak schedule. So what people also often do is to integrate the tweak and the key schedule into the tweak key schedule. In any case, so from our sign on the previous slide, we get this sign. It's very simple. Instead of one side input, we get two side inputs. Also, the whole state that the block cipher has to manage becomes bigger. So, where in a normal block cipher, you have the n-bit data and the k-bit key, here you have to manage the n-bit data, the k-bit key, and the w-bit tweak. So, instead of extending the block cipher, we can, of course, also try to do some minimalistic approach. And that's where I want to get at, of course. Instead of having a key in the block cipher, we just get rid of it. No key, no key, no tweak, just the data path. And the data path then becomes an n-bit permutation, but because we're speaking about the permutation, we use the term b to denote the width of the permutation. And there's nothing else, nothing up the sleeve anymore, a b-bit permutation. Now the birthday bound is at 2 to the power b divided by 2, still the same bound as for a block cipher, but because you can actually you don't have to manage this key separately. The only thing you need is this b-bit state. This can be made bigger for the same amount of memory usage. And where does the key go? Well, we'll put it one layer up, and that becomes clear on the next slide. So this traffic sign for the permutations suggests that it could be faster. Okay, so we had this standard block cipher-based crypto where we have a two-layer approach, where first we build a block cipher, and then we build a mode on top of a random permutation, and then we plug in the block cipher where the random permutation is. In permutation-based crypto, there's something similar, but it's a three-layer approach. And this third layer, well, the layer in the middle, is needed because a permutation doesn't have a key input, a dedicated key input. So first we build a permutation. And we don't make a claim or anything about the permutation. We just build a permutation. And then we construct a new kind of primitive a keyed primitive that we denote FK on top of the permutation. This primitive should have arbitrary length input and output. So this is the primitive that will kind of replace our block cipher, but where a block cipher is very rigorous, this has arbitrary length input and output. And this should be hard to distinguish from a random oracle. So from a random function with arbitrary length input and output, that's usually called a random oracle. So for an adversary with some given data and computational resources, it should be the advantage in distinguishing it from a random oracle should be smaller than some function. And how do we know that's the case? Well, that's public scrutiny. So it's basically these primitives with a concrete permutation used in it that will receive public scrutiny, that will need to be cryptanalyzed. So it's not a permutation that requires a cryptanalysis independent of the circumstance. No, it is the primitive FK with the permutation as a component. You can see it like a block cipher. The data path is also kind of a permutation. Huh? And you're not going to analyze data path separately. You're going to have to analyze the whole block cipher. So here it's kind of similar. So instead of trying to cryptanalyze the permutation as such, you have to cryptanalyze this thing.
John, can I ask something?
Yes.
So this one and two, so you say that one and two together is like building a block cipher, right?
Yes.
It's a new, because I mean, what goes into one?
Well, it's true. This one, you don't build it like that without thinking of this. So you first think how you would have to build a permutation to act, to perform well in this construction, and then you build the permutation.
Yes, okay. Yeah. So one and two is actually one.
Yeah, it's only one. No, yeah, it's only two, basically. Small two. And one is a building block. Okay. And it might well be that you can build good FKs without building a permutation, but building something else. Yeah. Yeah. But this is the focus of the cryptanalysis.
Okay.
That's the idea. Thanks. So then we build a mode on top of a random oracle. And in many cases, proving the security, if you assume a random oracle, is almost trivial. So because in many schemes, if you plug in a random oracle for the encryption or for the MAC computation, then that's very close to the security definition in the first case of the ideal scheme. But it's not always trivial, but in most of the cases it is. And then again, the security of a mode of this FK, you get again this sum of the two terms. One term that you can prove, and one term that you have to claim, and that is based on cryptanalysis. And the idea is to cryptanalyze these things in the same way that you do block ciphers. So for instance, you consider instantiations with a permutation with a reduced number of rounds. Okay, so now I will speak about what you can do with these DAC functions, this function FK that I call a DAC function, that we call a DAC function.
Johan,
Yes.
I have another question about, I think it's maybe better to ask later, but because I don't know what you're going to say, maybe I'm going to ask now and you can just say I should wait. For me, adding this key is also, I'm thinking about where the key is added in the middle. Yeah. So this key pass.
Yes,
you want to get rid of because of performance mainly, right? And it's also good for arguing about the security, right? So, I mean, just as an example, maybe it's not the most important example anymore because the data is crazy, but differential cryptanalysis.
Yes.
So, if you want to argue about the security of your scheme with respect to differential cryptanalysis, it's very helpful that you have this key addition because then you can argue about probability averaging over the key, right?
Yes.
And then you get something meaningful. And if you don't have this key, then this seems much harder, right? I mean, you can do the same. You can do the same computation, but it's less clear maybe what.
Yes. So then there is always a key. Yeah. So if you do differential cryptanalysis, we'll do it at this level.
Yes, but still, yeah, even there, probably you have a key at the very end and at the beginning and the end, maybe.
Yes, yes.
Right? So yes. There's one big block of a permutation that's maybe complicated. It could be a yes, right, with a fixed key. And then arguing about differential cryptanalysis for a fixed key AES is super hard.
Yes. Well, it depends. Yes, yes. But I think, yeah, so it depends if you speak about the trail. So you can, of course, always measure the weight of the trail. But the really DP of a trail, there you can only compute that if you make certain assumptions about independent of round differentials. But you can investigate that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. But yeah. And yeah. Okay. Okay. Because for me, besides this, sometimes I think maybe it would be nice to understand to build stronger security arguments.
Yes.
For all kinds of ciphers, yeah, and I think the one of the only ways I see how this can be improved is kind of you need this key. If you get rid of this key, then many arguments really break down completely. I agree that you can.
But many of these arguments I always fought, and like this Markov cipher theory, I always fought against it. Because if you have the complexity of differential cryptanalysis, the if you have an attack based on a differential, then the number of pairs you need is 1 over the DP of the differential, the expected number. But if the DP of the differential is an average over all keys, then for certain keys, you can be much, much more, can be much better behavior than for other keys. And actually, the average of the inverses of a lot of variables is not the same as 1 over the average. So it is, I've always found it a bit dangerous.
Yes, but I think it gets more dangerous now.
Yeah, I think not.
Okay.
But let's just see where we go.
Okay. There's another question in the chat.
Yes. Ah, there's a question in the chat.
So maybe just for everybody, it's better to ask this in the question and answer.
Yeah.
But so I'm just in the chat. There is how is mode defined in this context?
Ah, yeah.
Bernhard.
Yes. Mode. Like I can give examples, like ECB, CBC, counter mode, OCB. So it's something that makes use of a block cipher, for instance. In the case of blocks, makes use of a block cipher and achieves something more richer functionality. Typically, you can encrypt variable length messages. Or in case of authenticated encryption, you can authenticate and encrypt the message at the same time. So CCM is a typical mode. OCB is a mode. Yeah. I don't know if that answers the question.
I don't know either, but so if not, then Bernhard should raise it.
Yeah. I have here the question Q&A thing open, but the...
Yeah, I think that's enough. I think I'll have a look in the chat. If there's something, then I'll let you know. Otherwise, yeah. Okay. Thanks.
But the whole message up to now is we want to try to, we propose to replace block cipher at the center of crypto by this new type of primitive that we, in our case, built on permutations. So we call this a DEC function, and we define an interface. So a DEC function is a keyed function that takes as input a sequence of messages, a sequence of inputs, sequence of strings. So in this case, a string 1, x1, followed by x2, followed by, and so on to xn. And it will generate an output that is, in principle, an infinite string that should be completely independent for different input sequences. So even if you have input sequences that if you concatenate the strings is the same, these separations between the strings matter. So two different input sequences should give completely independent random outputs. And we don't indicate in this notation the output length. No, we always add it to something. This is a binary addition, the bitwise addition, add it to something with a particular length. So this is to say we take n bits of this output. That's virtually infinite, but we take n bits. And this thing here says we skip the first q bits. So if this would be not there, then we would take the first n bits of the output sequence generated by this function. What this additionally does is we take the bit starting from bit q to bit q plus n of the output of this function. That's the notational definition. And the term DEC stands for doubly extendable cryptographic keyed function. What does this mean? So I said that the input is a sequence of strings, output is potentially infinite, extendable. So that should be efficiently incrementable. So what does that mean? If you have computed fk of some input string x or of some input string sequence x, then computing the output to an input sequence the same but with another string appended to it, it can be done for an implementation cost independent of x. So basically, it says the function keeps state, and whenever from a certain state, you can go on. So if you compute it over x, then computing over y after x, it just will involve the processing of this y, and you don't have to process this x again. And the output is the same. If you have requested the number of bits from the output, from, let's say, offset zero, so the first n1 bits, then computing the subsequent n2 bits should also be able to do it for a cost that's independent of n1. So that's this doubly extendable. You can extend its input cheaply, you can extend its output cheaply. And that's very useful in defining certain modes. Okay, let's take a look at the first application. Let's say we need a stream cipher. Well, if we have such a function, it's very easy to do. This symbolizes our function, our fk, our DEC function, where we input the key that's actually loaded in the beginning. Then we provide the function with a nonce, so that's the input of the function. And we generate output that is used as key stream to encrypt the plaintext by just adding to it. Yeah? So we bitwise add this randomly looking key stream to the plaintext, and that gives the ciphertext. So now if we have to encrypt two different plaintexts, we just have to make sure we use a different nonce. If we use different nonces, then according to the security definition, this will generate seemingly completely unrelated output sequences, so seemingly unrelated key streams. And if they're not unrelated, then we have an attack against the function, because it would be easy to distinguish from a random one. So it's very simple. It's almost simple as you can make it. And for a MAC, it's similarly simple. In this case, you present to the function the message you want to MAC. Let's say this is the plain text that you want to compute a MAC over, and then you take just the first t bits of the output, and that's the tag. Yeah? And you can easily see that you can combine these two to do authenticated encryption. So first, for instance, you encrypt your plain text, then you compute a MAC over it. At the receiving end, you verify your MAC over the ciphertext you received, and then you decrypt your ciphertext to the plain text. Okay, now let's take a look at a bit more sophisticated modes. This is one of the modes we defined in a document we call the Zulu Cookbook. That's on ePrint. At some point, we want to publish this because it's not really at the peer-reviewed conference. And this is a session-supporting authenticated encryption scheme that is based on a nonce. So basically, we initialize the scheme with a key and a nonce, both at receiver and sender side. We have an initial tag that sending side will generate, and the receiving side can verify. And if there's no tag, then the receiving side will not even accept messages. And then we have a sequence of messages, each consisting of associated data plain text, associated data plain text, and so on. Every time there is a message, the plain text will be encrypted to a ciphertext, and there will be a tag computed over the two. And in general, the tag is computed over everything that came before. So how is this implemented with a DEC function in the mode DEC SANE? I don't remember what SANE stands for. It's, I think, session authenticated encryption nonce based. Yes. Session authenticate encryption nonce based. So we initialize the session with a nonce. And we assume the key is already there. We generate a tag T0. Let's say we're in a client server. The client always takes initiative to start a new session. Client will send the request to the server. The server will receive the T0 and the nonce. The server will verify whether this tag is correct for the given nonce. If that is the case, he will accept the request. Otherwise, he will refuse. That we call the startup tag. It's not so important. But then how do we encrypt the message? Well, the message one, first we encrypt the plain text. We encrypt the plain text by just applying our function, our DEC function, to the nonce. But we already use the first T bits of this output sequence, so we will just take the following bits. So we will start only at offset T in the output, and we will generate as much key stream as the plain text is long. So if this is a plain text of 1 megabyte, we will generate 1 megabyte keystream, and that's our ciphertext. Then we will absorb our associated data and our ciphertext into the function and compute a T-bit tag. So here we don't need an offset because this is a fresh input. So this nonce, we don't need to process anymore because it was already processed. We only need to process this part. And we can go on like this. If I can still find the button to go forward instead of backwards. For message two, we do the same. First, we encrypt the plain text by just extending the output of FK. So this FK with the first n bits we already used for the tag of the previous message, we just go on after T bits. And we don't need to process any input. And we generate as much keystream bits as P2 is long. And then we generate a tag by first absorbing A2 and C2 and generating the first T bits. And that's it. So and so on and so on and so on. It's quite simple. So if our function FK is secure, then each of these keystream outputs and tags are completely unpredictable. At receiving end, the probability of guessing a tag randomly is very small, 2 over -t. But if you guess it correctly, you can basically forge a message. So you get, if you, you have to make your tag long enough to get, if you want 128 bits of security, then strictly speaking, your tag should be 128 bits. Very simple. Now, this requires a nonce. If you start two sessions with the same nonce, then here you get the same startup tag. And also, what's worse, here you will encrypt two plain texts with the same key stream. Yeah? And that means that the corresponding ciphertext will leak information about the plain text because the bitwise addition of the plain text will be equal to the bitwise addition of the ciphertext. So that is a bad thing, and there is some tendency of people to believe that it's hard to generate nonces and to maintain nonces. So for that reason, we just also defined an session supporting authenticated encryption scheme that is not nonce based. Well, it is still nonce based, but the nonce is created inside the mode, so the user doesn't have to provide a nonce. So here there is an implicit session setup that happens with the first message. And there is no explicit diversifier. So what you first do is you generate your tag, and this tag will serve as an nonce to do the encryption. So we generate the tag over the combination of the associated data and the plain text. And we append some domain separation bits so that we can actually afford to have, for instance, no associated data or no plain text. Because a plain text block always ends in one, and an associated data, a plain text string always ends in one, and an associated data always ends in zero. Once we generated the tag, we compute the ciphertext by encrypting the plain text by addition of a key stream that we obtain in the following way. We absorb the combination of associated data and the tag. This associated data we already processed here, so we can actually here in the middle keep state and use it, reuse it later. And this tag makes sure that if we have two different inputs, PA, well, it does not ensure, but it makes it very likely that the tags will be different. If we have associated data that in two different occasions is different, then that's already good enough. So in any case, so even if the associated data is the same, but the plain text is different, then this tag will very likely be different if you have different plain texts. And that avoids collisions in the input of FK. And that gives completely unrelated output streams. In this case, when you do at the receiving end, you first have to decrypt and only then you can, so you have to decrypt using your associated data and your tag, and only then you can decipher. So the advantage of the other mode is that first you verify your tag, and if the tag is incorrect, you don't even have to decrypt. In this case, you always have to decrypt, and only then you can verify. You first have to decrypt, and only then you can verify that it's an authentic message by verifying the tag. Okay, so this can go on. So you see that what you basically do is you every time load to your you keep state in your function FK and you load new plain text and associated data. So you build some kind of history and the history goes into your FK and your FK keep state. That's what you do. This is based on the idea of Frog Arrange Shrimpen, this SIV mode, but the original SIV is not session-based, and it also doesn't make use of this associated data, because I think they didn't even consider associated data. Now, the advantage of this is that if you encrypt many messages with the same key, that you can get collisions in your tag. So let's say you would have only a 64-bit tag, and about after about 2 to the power 32 messages, you can get collisions in the tag after 2 to the power 32 sessions, basically. So that means that if you have a 128-bit tag, you only get 64 bits of security, strictly speaking. And for that, you can actually apply a different method. And for that method, you need a wide block cipher. And this is a way to build a wide block cipher, where wide means a block cipher with flexible input length, starting from some given length, from a DAC function, or from a pair of DAC functions, basically. So we have here the other way around, where usually we take a block cipher and we build something, some mode on top of it. Here we build a block cipher on the basis of a DAC function. But it's not a simple block cipher with fixed length, it's a wide block cipher with which takes a tweak. And I will show on the next slide how this can be used. So it can actually encipher a plain text of any length, where so there is some minimum length with a key, and also taking a tweak that can have infinite length. There is no length restriction on the tweak. And basically what you do is you split your plain text in two parts, L and R. And this length of these substrings is completely determined by the length of P. And then you apply four rounds. It's like this Luby-Rakov kind of scheme, where you apply the function. You have two functions, this HK and GK. And the difference is that HK, they have some less strict security requirements than GK. You apply HK to the left part, you add it to the right part, then you apply GK to the right part, and to the tweak, and you added the left part, then again you do this again in the other direction, so GK to the left part, added to the right part, and then finally HK to the right part, added to the left part. And of course the inverse of this is a very similar process. The tweak goes on in the goes in the middle round, and your ciphertext has a length equal to the length of P. So this is something we were not able to prove the security of, assuming that these functions satisfy certain requirements. But this has been done of by one of my students, Aldo Gunzing, who had a paper on it at TUSC 2019, the fourth issue. So we would present this year at FSC. So it hasn't been presented yet. It's quite nice proof. And how can we use this for authenticated encryption? Well, what we can do is basically we can take the plain text. We can append some redundancy, let's say 4 bytes equal to 0. We apply the white block cipher on it based on the DEC function. This, we can put the associated data in the tweak input and we get a ciphertext. If we then later decrypt, we can just decrypt, given ciphertext, the associated data, we get the plain text, and this should be 0. So if we said here, this is, if we agree in our scheme that any plain text, any input to the DEC Y block cipher ends with 32 bits equal to 0, then this should end with 32 bits equal to 0. So here we can actually get, we don't need a nonce, and we still get T bits of security with T bits of redundancy. So if you want 128 bits of security, it's just here append 128 bits equal to 0. Even if the plain text has some inherent redundancy, like let's say it's ASCII text, and if it's sufficient amount of text, then we can also base ourselves on this inherent redundancy. So this is also not an idea of ours, this is an idea of Phil Roderick, Ted Krovets, and Huang. That was presented already 5 years ago. But we just build the function that we need to instantiate it, this double deck.
Johan?
Yes.
And this in this double deck function, so this H and G,
yeah,
these are again deck functions.
Yeah, this is a deck function.
Okay.
And this is a deck function that where you it doesn't have to be secure. It doesn't have to be indistinguishable from a random oracle. It should just be indistinguishable from a random oracle if you filter it by another random oracle. So basically, this is like a differentially uniform function, isn't it?
Okay.
And we can make it a bit lighter.
Okay.
So I see I'm already 53 minutes far. I don't know, Gregor, what you think. If I go on like this, probably take 1.5 hours.
I think it's very interesting, but I think the most people expected this whole thing to last like an hour. So I think we're going to see some people leaving.
Yeah, but that's for me not a problem.
No, but yeah.
I can just go on and people can leave.
Yes, but it would maybe be nice to... I agree that that's one option.
Yeah.
Maybe in order to avoid that at the end it's only you and me talking, then we can maybe have some finish at some point so that we can discuss maybe and take more questions if people are hesitating.
Yeah.
So maybe, I don't know, what is a good, you decide when it's a good...
I will see. So maybe then in 5 minutes I try to... I think now it goes also a bit faster, the first
one. Okay. Yeah, so...
Okay. So how can we build a DEC function? So I'm not saying this is the only way to build DEC functions, but these are ways to build DEC functions. And the first thing is the keyed duplex object. That is the, let's say, what came from duplex, that came from Sponge. Sponge is the mode used in SHA-3 and Ketchup. And the keyed duplex object basically is the following. You got this thing that has a state. The state is the width of this permutation, so this f is a permutation. And initially, you write in the state, you write a key, an unknown key, that can be taken from an array of keys. So you have multi-user, multi-key security, and an IV. That's the kind of the diversifier that will serve a diversifier. And then you apply a function f, and you can extract bits of output. So part of the state goes to the output. And then you can inject an input string over the complete state. Then you can extract again R bits of input, output, and so on. So this is kind of a DAC function, but it only allows input strings of some maximum length. Can be shorter, but it has some maximum length, which is B bits, and it only allows output strings of also some maximum length. But you can build on this a layer that does some input parsing and stuff, and that makes it a true DAC function. So we did that in Subterranean. Zodiac is maybe not completely that, but close to it, and Strobe of Mike Hamburg is something the same. So these are NIST-like candidates. Cryptanalysis, well, how do we cryptanalyze this? Well, we plug in a real permutation like Ketchak F or ASCON permutation or so, and we try to attack it. And we try to attack reduced round versions, and that then gives an idea about security. But in this talk, I want to talk more about a parallel structure. Yeah, this is actually only useful in interactive presentation. Then I try to ask the audience what would be the name, and they don't know. There is a question. Why do we need this length? We don't need a length restriction, but it's inherently there. So you see here this Z, you can only output part of the state. And actually, the security is determined by the part of the state you cannot output. So per string, you can only output that amount. So if you absorb a sequence of strings, then you can only extract at most R bits. Also, the input strings, if you don't put this layer on top, you can, each string is only limited to B bits or B minus one, because you also need some padding. Once you put a layer on top of it, you can actually make sure that all strings are variable length. But internally you will do this. And this is also what you will cryptanalyze. So this is kind of the atomic building block. This would be the thing that you, is at the level of the block size. But we can extract up to another R bits. Yes, but that's another output. That's not the extraction of the same output at this level. Huh? It's not so important, I think. You can extract an infinite number of bits, but then you have to make sure that you code your input. You have to put a layer on top to code your input. It's more at the conceptual level. But this is the thing you cryptanalyze. But it's more about parallel. So this is a butterfly in Italian is farfalle, and this I think everybody knows as farfalle. And the construction looks a lot like it, at least the initial construction. And the remainder of the talk is mostly about this construction. So maybe I can quickly, what these slides do is they give kind of historical reason for why certain things are in the construction. But what I can do is I can go to the slide that sums this all up without discussing the attacks in detail to show you a bit what the philosophy is. So what you have is, you have here the input. The input M, which is a sequence of strings. And the sequence of strings is actually cut up into a number of blocks. And these blocks, they have a fixed length. Yeah? So your input is a sequence of strings of variable length. And these are cut up also by part of the algorithm, but that's not shown here, into equal length blocks. And these length of these blocks is the width of the permutation. So this is a permutation. There's actually 1, 2, 3, 4 different permutations, but in reality, they're often the same. In our modes where we define them, they're actually the same. So how do we treat a message block? Well, we add to a message, we add a mask. And this mask is unknown to the attacker. It's derived from a key. So this is the user key. And from the user key, we pad it and apply a permutation, and that gives this mask. And the mask is just applied as such to the first message block. Second message block it goes through an LFSR. Third message block, it goes to the LFSR twice and so on. So basically this is serial, but this is completely parallel. So you can process these in parallel as soon as you generate these masks. So these masks you can generate in advance, but it's also the case that this function is very parallelizable and very lightweight. So then all these inputs, so each input to the permutation is a message block and this mask, where the mask is different for each block. These are applied, there we apply the permutation, PC, and they are added modulo 2. You can also have another group, but we add a modulo 2, and that we call the accumulator. And then the accumulator is again going through a permutation, that's typically the same as this. And then we start generating output. So this, we call this the expansion phase, where we first just take the value of this output. We call that the rolling state. And we apply this permutation, add again a mask, and that's the first output block. Then we apply this rolling function to the state. Once we apply PE, and we get the second output block. So again, with the same mask and so on and so on. So this typically would be an LFSR, and it was an LFSR, but then we got a very bad attack and we made it an NLFSR. So now the philosophy is the following. There are three types of attack. One type of attack is an attack where you only look at input and you completely ignore this and you try to generate a collision here. Yeah? And this attack is independent of whatever happens after here and is completely determined by this function PC and this rolling function that we are studying for the moment in our group. The second type of attack is an attack where you just assemble output blocks and you try to reconstruct this rolling state and this key. This attack is completely independent of what happens here before. The third, all other types of attack, you need to consider input and output together. So you need to consider queries where you investigate the input to the output, or you try to relate the input to the output. And the idea is that that's not so easy because you have to go through three permutations to get from input to output. Yeah. So if this is, for instance, 12 round, let's say 4 round AES, then you would have to go through 12 rounds AES. You can say, yeah, but here you can generate a collision. Yes, but then you have to here look at 4 round AES. Yes, but you can here reconstruct the state. Yeah, then you have to consider this. So the idea is that basically attacks that involve both input and output, they have to go through all this stuff. But the additional cost for processing one more message block is just this, you see? So if you have here a million of input blocks and you have just one output block when you compute a MAC, you only have the cost is only one PC per input block. And then for all of the input blocks together, you just get one and one, see? Also, when you generate a long key stream based on a short input, you just have to do per output block, you have to do this process. So that makes it potentially very efficient. But of course, there is some new type of cryptanalysis needed, namely this collision search. And here, you need to do like a kind of stream cipher analysis. And that's what we in our group are now doing. And we learn a lot. And we learn about what we did in the concrete case. So I'll go to, I'm not going to explain all this. Sorry. Yes?
There's a question by Baptiste. It's a long question. Yes. So maybe I cannot, but maybe you can make Baptiste speak.
I can do that.
Yes, because you're the host now. So I think you go to the list of Zuschauer and I guess. Yes, participants, and then...
Allowed to talk, yes.
I don't know if Baptiste actually wants to
can
talk.
Can you hear me?
Yes, very good.
Nice. Okay, so I'm not very used to hardware implementation, but I will try to ask a question anyway. So from what I understand, for deck functions, you essentially need to keep a state if you want to have an efficient computation when you extend the input.
Yes,
But if you think about implementing this in hardware, it means that you need some additional memory cells to keep the state.
Yes.
And I think that memory in hardware can be actually expensive when you think about the size of the implementation. So if you compare the use of deck functions to, let's say, just a block or stream cipher,
yes. It
seems like for the same performances, a deck function needs to have a bigger hardware implementation. So is this true? Or does the requirements or construction of the deck function would allow to actually reduce the size of the implementation and loss so that the additional memory is not really an issue?
No, so yeah, you cannot speak about deck function. You have to specify either Farfalle or Sponge or Duplex. And Duplex is kind of designed to have very small memory footprint. Farfalle has bigger memory footprint because you need to keep track of this thing. You need to keep track of this thing. And you need to keep track of data. Whenever you have to write away state, there's more to it. So Farfalle is not really memory. It needs a lot of memory, but many block cipher modes also need a lot of memory. So in Sponge, there you are much more, you have much less memory requirements. So, and also in the classical Sponge-based duplex modes, like a Sponge Wrap or Duplex Wrap, there the memory requirements are much less. But in reality, what I learned from at ST is that memory is not such a big deal. Actually, you have typically a lot of RAM that you need for application. So I what I learned is that is not so expensive.
Okay, I'm not really aware of any hardware, but I was wondering what. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, but it's so that Farfalle is not really memory. It uses quite some memory, and especially as you say, if you have to safeguard your state every now and then, and that you have because you typically go on where you left off. Also in the Sansa mode, that's a limitation, or that's a disadvantage, let's say. Oh, yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. So, I will now go to a later slide. I think I will just try to just close. If there's people interested to still discuss, we can discuss. But this is how incrementality is implemented, but that's a technical detail. So concretely, because up to now it's been very abstract, we built a deck function, Farfalle-based deck function on a permutation called Zuru that we published a few years ago. And it was triggered by the design of Gimli. That was an initiative, I think it was at the Lorenz workshop, that a big team got together in a room and they came up with a 384-bit permutation. And that was an idea of Dan Bernstein. And the idea was that this 384-bit, that's a nice soft spot where you have something that is very compact on low end. It fits in the registers of an ARM Cortex-M3 and 4, which is kind of a very prominent platform in low end, in lightweight crypto. But it's also fast on high end, and you can do really exploit SIMD instructions on a high end CPU and modern high end CPU. So it's very, very flexible, good design. But when plugging it in into Farfalle, we wouldn't know how many rounds to take. It's 24 rounds, and that we thought it was a really big overhead. It was much too big because it would mean in the total permutation you would have 72 rounds. And we had no idea to cut it short, and the bounds on the trails were not so great. So we said, let's do it something ourselves based on like Ketchakev. We do the same size because that's a brilliant idea. And we apply the Ketchakev loss. And we learned a lot also about Ketchak. We learned that actually the Zuru is the Ketchak F we could do much better, and that's what we call Zuru. And we're still learning. And the main purpose of Zuru was to use in Farfalle, and that we called Zuf. Zuf, because that suggests speed. Huh? That is three Fs. And it's the same goals as Gimli, but then really focused on Zuru. And so this is what it looks like. I'm not going, but yeah, I can maybe say something about the bound. So the bound that we claimed, this is a simplified bound, but it basically looks like this. So we get here a term that corresponds to exhaustive key search. For any key length, you get k bits of security. That's basically what this says. Except if the key is bigger than 192. Then it's like there's a plateau. You cannot get more than 192 bits of security. So we don't guarantee anything above 192 bits. And here, this is kind of a collision probability. We think it would be very unlikely that someone can come up with an attack that generates a collision with a probability higher than this thing. So M is the data complexity, a number of blocks, and N is the computation complexity, a number of computations of F, where F is pseudo with six rounds. So cryptanalysis, this is just a claim, so there is no proof. So we invite everyone to cryptanalyze this, and in our group, we are actually currently doing it a lot, and we learn a great deal. So if you look at performance, let's take a look at this ARM Cortex M0. That's a 32-bit CPU, the really low end. And you can see that, for instance, yeah, this is the fixed cost to do something. But once you have initialized, you can process long inputs at 26 cycles per byte. For MAC computation, so that means long input, short output. And for stream encryption, short input, long output, it's 25 cycles per byte. And if you compare that to AES in counter mode, AES on 28, that's about 5 times slower. On ARM Cortex M3, that's a bit higher up the ladder. It's a more efficient platform with some more instructions and also more registers. You see that the cost drops down to 8.8 cycles per byte, but AES also drops down, but the ratio stays more or less the same. So it's kind of 4 times faster than AES on both these low-end platforms. If we go to modern high-end platforms, like what you find in a laptop, like this Intel Core i5, then you see that actually you get less than one cycle per byte, but AES is faster. But this is because we use here the AES built-in instruction. So what this says is that we almost get the performance of AES in counter mode without a dedicated instruction. So AES, that's really AES round hardware in the CPU. And even with that, we get very close. And on the more modern CPU, the Skylake X, it has better SIMD instructions, and there we actually beat AES in counter mode. So it's kind of very, this should at least stimulate people to cryptanalyze this, because this says that it is faster than AES, where for AES you have actually built-in hardware instructions that take a lot of real estate in the CPU, while we just use general purpose instructions. So yeah, then I got my conclusions. I will show them. So basically you can use DAC functions for anything you want. You can build DAC functions from permutations. I'm not saying this is the only way to do it, but this is at least, I think, a good way to do it. You can make something compact, key duplex. You can make something that is less compact, but is more parallelizable and more these compact versions, they always have this bottleneck that you can only, that you cannot parallelize. Well, for Farfalle, you can parallelize very well, but it is a cost, it needs more state. And if you, for instance, take the use case of Zudu, where we built Zoof, you can see that it gives a very competitive DAC function. And I think this is a viable alternative for block cipher based. So that's what I had planned. Well, I skipped some of the slides, but I think this gives the general idea.
Okay, thank you very much, Johan. I tried to start my video again, but it doesn't work because...
Maybe I have to stop sharing.
I don't know, but don't, because it's good maybe for questions to.
Okay, I can always go back.
So there's a question from Kfi.
Yes.
You can give him speaking rights if you want. Yeah.
Kfi, yeah, I think it's a very good question. To currently use stream ciphers, so like ChaCha20. I think we have comparisons with ChaCha20. So what is actually powerful?
So I'm just repeating the question. Or maybe you give him speaking rights then?
Yeah, I give him speaking rights.
Right. You can, yeah, okay. I'm sorry that you have to do it, but so...
No, it's fine. I know now how to do it, so if I can still follow my... I don't know where but my mouse is gone.
Sorry.
I'm sorry. I don't know what happened.
Yeah. Okay, then don't give me speaking.
It works. Yes. Okay. Yeah. You can now talk.
I will try if you can hear me.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Cool. Yeah, I wrote down my question, right? I was wondering how this compares to currently used stream ciphers, for example, in TLS 1.3, Dan Bernstein's cha-cha cipher.
Very good question. So what you have to see here is that if you compare this to cha-cha, you have to consider a short input and a long output, right? So what you have to do per output block is this. You get 384 bits of output per call to F, and F has 6 rounds. So now it's, of course, the question, what do you want to compare with? If you want to compare with Salsa 20 or Cha-Cha 20 or Cha-Cha 12 or Cha-Cha 8, so that will make a big difference. You see what I mean?
Sorry, I'm losing connection right now. So I was asking for on a high level, are there any like security benefits or is it just performance?
Security of Cha-Cha is also based on public scrutiny. And mm-hmm. security of this is also based on public scrutiny. You see? But you can here, for instance, this app, you could plug in also Salsa or Cha-Cha permutation. So because it's also based on a permutation. So mm-hmm. that would be a possibility. You have to also, for this performance, of course, you have to compare on which platform you're looking. So what I know is that Salsa and Cha-Cha, they're very, very efficient in software. Yeah? So they are specially designed for software. If you do this in hardware, basically, this is, for Zulu, you will get a very performant hardware because that's there's very small gate delay, while in Cha-Cha or Salsa you got this addition where you have this carry effect that makes that you cannot clock too fast. For instance, this thing you can do basically if you have enough hardware resources, you can build a fully unrolled implementation. Typically 6 rounds that you can do in a single clock cycle. Yeah? So it just depends on what you want to compare.
Okay, cool. So with this, you're aiming for like hardware applications. You're not aiming to replace.
No, we're not aiming for hardware applications alone. If you look at this, this means that it's also software very performant.
Okay.
Yeah. Now for the question for the absorbing side. So what we actually claim here is that we claim 128 bits of security for collisions, let's say. Yeah, in poly 1305, if I'm not mistaken, it works modulo a prime to the power 130 plus 5 or something, or minus 5. So there you can get at most 64 bits of security. So you get there typically a term m squared divided by 2 to the power 64. 2 to the power 128. Well, we at m squared divided by 2 to the power 130 or something. Well, we get m divided by 2 to the power 128. So we also aim for a higher security level there.
Okay, that's cool. Would you say this is like actual necessary for real?
No, I would not say it's necessary. No, I would not call that necessary. What you have here also is that if you want to implement this in hardware, you only need to implement one permutation. Well, poly 1305 and Salsa or Cha-Cha, you have two distinct components.
Yeah, I see. Thank you so much.
Yeah. But you can actually build something like this where you would plug in here something poly 1305 like, and here you would build in something Salsa or Cha-Cha like. That would make perfectly sense. And if you look at this submission, HS1SIV, that was a submission to the CSAR competition, they had something similar without explicitly saying it. So they had actually this kind of structure where you compress with NH, UMAC-like thing, and also 41305, and where you have an expansion based on Cha-Cha or Salsa. But it's not completely this. We try to just build one function and use that function all over, while they had more, it was more like dispersed.
Okay, Johan, thank you very much. I have more questions.
I have all of them.
So I have a question. So you said that I'm still struggling with these permutation-based things. Yeah, but now I think it's you kind of left room because you said with all these arguments about security, security arguments seem still for me much more difficult for permutations. But you said that you could also build something not on permutation based, right? All these F don't have to be permutations, but it could be block ciphers whose inverse are not efficient, right? So that would make, that would make sense and would probably allow a better security arguments, right?
I don't know what you call better security.
What I said about these trails, like multiplying probabilities, you get something.
Yeah.
And there are also other cases. It's too technical, I think, now. But for example, all these distinguishers, right? There's always this talk about distinguishers. Yeah. You had this for Ketchak, you have this now for Spook, and you have this for Gimli. And I'm just saying,
don't care about distinguishers here.
No, I know.
We care about distinguishers here between input and output.
No, I know that you don't care, and I think that's the right thing to do, but there are still all these papers that appear, and they say, okay, we have a distinguisher on the permutation.
Yes.
Which I don't know what to think about this, right? So some of this, I think, is interesting insights, maybe. They don't mean a lot by themselves, but they might lead to something. But all this unprecise things, the unprecise definition of what all these distinguishers mean, they can be avoided, I think, if you would use more key additions, basically.
Yes, but Gregor, if you look at hashing,
it's the same. Yes,
in hashing there is no key, so you have to live with that anyway in hashing.
Yes, for hashing, yes, but just as a goal, it would be nice to minimize the assumptions as far as possible, right? So, because this is important, right? If we we are going to base quite some trust into this if it's really deployed, and then it would be nice if we maybe pay some performance in order to get better security arguments, So, and then maybe adding a bit more key would be a valid option. Is this
yesterday? If you look at sidechain attacks, every time you apply the key, you can leak the key. So this block cipher based, you all the time add the key, and every time you add the key, you can leak.
Yes, I agree.
But of course, it's here too. You also add the key here.
Okay. Do you think that it's going to cost something in performance, right? If you add the key more, it's going to. You have to pay for this, I guess, in performance. Do you think performance is super critical? Is it really, from your experience, from industry, is it...
Where do you want to add the key?
I don't know, but just one thing, if you have a block cipher instead of a permutation, you will have to add the key more than once, right? You will do some XOR with the key. That's going to cost something.
Yeah, but the cost is not so big.
Okay. No. So it's not necessarily less efficient, right? If you use a reduced round block cipher stuff, it's not, or it doesn't have to be a block cipher, just a more keyed. I just would like to have more keys in between the rounds.
Yeah, you can have keys in between the rounds, but I personally don't see the advantage.
You don't see the advantage of this better security argument?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't. I never bought these security arguments.
No, I don't. I think they are not perfect, but I think so. If you want to get better ones, then. I agree they are not perfect, but if you want to improve on this, I think removing the key is not the right direction. That's basically what I want to say.
Okay. Yeah, of course, but I think it's the right direction. But
okay,
are you gonna add subkeys that are supposedly random and mutually independent, or are you gonna add the same key all over the place?
I was thinking that maybe for some application, it's really a question of applications, right? So for some application, you say, okay, let's just take random independent subkeys. Yeah, that's, of course, it's going to cost something in performance because suddenly the key is 1,000 bits.
Yes.
Yeah, but for most applications, it's probably not a big deal.
No.
They can easily deal with this. Yeah. And then you really get security arguments that are more meaningful, I think. And then it's up to the application to decide if this is worth it or not.
Yes. Yeah, I wouldn't do it, but I see your argument, yes.
Okay. Okay, so there are no more questions. Thank you very much. And there are no more questions from other people. So I think then we can close this. Okay. Johan, thank you very much. It was very interesting.
Thank you.
We had a good participation. I think that it's
a lot of people. Yeah.
Yes, I think it's a lot of people. Now it's reduced a bit, but that's for 1.5 hours. It's still more than 30.
Yeah.
And it was more than 60 in the meantime. Oh, so that's very nice, I think. Yeah. So thank you very much.
Yeah, I hope I stimulate some discussion in the future.
I think it's for me certainly. Okay. I cannot. That's one of the negative things about this virtual thing. You cannot look into the faces of people and if they. If they okay, I don't know. I would assume they.
Everybody's asleep, maybe. Yeah.
No. I don't think so. Okay, so thank you very much, Johan.
Bye.
Bye.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks everybody for listening. Bye.
Thank you.